सूत्रास भगवद्गीता सर्वधर्मान परित्यज्य। दिस इज द टाइटल ऑफ द टॉक। द टाइटल कम्स फ्रॉम द सूत्र 66 ऑफ चैप्टर 18। सर्वधर्मान परित्यज्य मामेकं शरणं व्रज अहं त्वं सर्व पापेभ्यो मोक्षयिष्यामि मा शुच। सर्वधर्मान, सर्व मीन्स ऑल, धर्मान मीन्स धर्म, सर्वधर्मान परित्यज्य, परित्यज्य मीन्स अबंडन, अबंडन ऑल द रिलीजन्स। सर्वधर्मान परित्यज्य मामेकं शरणं व्रज, कम टू माय शेल्टर, कम टू माय रिफ्यूज। अहम त्वं सर्व पापेभ्यो मोक्षयिष्यामि मा शुच। अहम, आई, त्वं, यू, सर्व पापेभ्यो, ऑल सिंस, सर्व पापेभ्यो मोक्षयिष्यामि मा शुच। मोक्ष मीन्स लिबरेशन, अबंडनिंग ऑल द रिलीजन्स। कम टू मी एंड मी अलोन, आई शैल लिबरेट दी ऑफ thy sins. This is very important and very often used and quoted sutra. This is the last sutra that Yogeshwari spoke to Arjun in the sequence of sutras or his guidance or training in the process of transformation of Arjun. After this sutra, whatever has been spoken is spoken by Sanjay the narrator, who narrates the, who gives online commentary or narrates this, whatever is going on the battlefield, to the blind king Dhritarashtra. Before we go into the insights of the sutra, it is important to know certain things. I have heard a Muslim king had a slave. The slave was very loving. The king loved him dearly. The slave was very devoted. One day the two were passing through the forest. On the way, the king picked up a fruit and gave a peck to the slave. The slave went on asking more and more, and the king went on giving until he reached the last peck. That too the slave wanted, but the king wanted to taste at least one peck, as there was no other fruit. And from the gestures of the slave, it looked like the fruit was very tasty. So instead of giving the last peck to the slave, the king tasted himself. And as the king put the peck in his mouth, he could not eat. The fruit was very bitter. This surprised the king, because the slave did not complain of the taste of the fruit. Each time the slave ate the fruit, he relished as if he is tasting or eating something very delicious. The fruit was bitter like poison. It was difficult even to taste the fruit or keep it in the mouth, what to talk of eating, and eating with so much of pleasant gestures. Surprisingly, the king inquired from the slave, "How could you eat the entire fruit joyfully? Why did you not complain?" And the reply of the slave is beautiful. The slave responded, "These hands have given so many joyous moments, so many joyous moments that have come like blessings. Then how can I complain for one bitter fruit?" The slave responded, "These hands have given so many joyous moments that have come like blessings, then how can I complain for one bitter fruit? This is the response of the one who knows. This is the reply of a religious one. Our life is a life of complaint, that God did not give me this, God that did not give me. Life of a religious person, the so-called religious person, is full of complaint and asking. The day you will understand that all that happens in your life is because of a cosmic law or harmony, how can you reject sorrows and afflictions? This is the meaning of surrender. Surrender does not mean you surrender for all that is good. When Krishna says, Sarva Dharmana Parityajya, abandon all the religions. Religion means that which is known, the way. When you accept everything that comes in your life, the sorrows and afflictions, the joys, then and only then your surrender can be complete. Because when you are accepting the moments of happiness and joys, you are prejudiced, you are divided. And when you accept everything, you have understood the very phenomena of the existence. You go on accepting all that is pleasant in your life and rejecting all that is not acceptable to you. You are living by your will, by your desires, by your way. Nanak calls this as Manmukh, one who lives by his own mind. And the other word is Gurumukh, who has turned himself towards the Master, towards consciousness, towards existence. Whatsoever consciousness brings, whatsoever existence brings, whatsoever cosmic law brings, you live by that, is the meaning of surrender, is the meaning of Gurumukh. The day you understand all that happens in life is because of the cosmic law, or all that is happening because of the divine will, how can you reject sorrows and afflictions? You are not able to see the truth. When leaves fall from the tree during autumn and tree becomes bare, this is not the end. When problem comes, when there is sorrow and afflictions, everything seems to be slipping out of your hands, that is not the end of the life. This is the way of the tree, this is the way of an awakened one, this is the way to grow into awakening. Each time when autumn comes, old leaves fall and new leaves grow on the tree during the time of spring. This is the way of the growth of the tree. Both sorrows and happiness are two shores of the river of life. The river of life cannot flow without these two shores. The day you are beyond the duality of happiness and sorrows, bliss or anand happens. When duality is no more, oneness remains. Nothing is beyond this cosmic law. Both happiness and sorrows are the outcome of this cosmic law. And this understanding, such an understanding that everything is the outcome of the cosmic law, brings blessings for someone. It is because of this cosmic law that someone remains within the cycle of birth and death. And one who has really understood this cosmic law is free from ego and attains to oneness and the journey of the life beyond the dualities begins. This is the essence of all religions and understanding of all Buddhas. This is religiousness. Religiousness does not mean going to the temple, churches, mosques, gurdwaras or any other place of your worship, or holding the scriptures in your hand. People use the scriptures as props. If you take away the scriptures from the hands of the people, they cannot sustain. A Hindu cannot sustain without Bhagavad Gita. A Christian cannot sustain without Bible. A Muslim cannot sustain without Quran. It is like these scriptures comes like the stick of the blind man. Blind man cannot walk without this stick. So you are like that blind man who cannot walk without his stick. And the growth happens when you abandon all this. Even the scriptures are not relevant to you. And this is what Krishna means by saying sarva dharmana paritijya. The scriptures are the embodiment of the religion. All the scriptures, body has its rules, mind has its rules, it has to follow certain discipline. When you are going into these disciplines which are ritualistic in nature, you cannot understand the cosmic law. You can put on the garb of a religious one, but this cannot give you a religious quality indeed, or make you religious indeed. It happens many times, realizing the futility of ego, you want to drop the ego. Yet still you cannot drop ego. What can you really do? What can really be the cause of this ego? Ego gives you happiness. This alone is the problem. This is true as well. All suffering, misery and pain come because of ego and lack of understanding. Because ego beclouds your cognition. When your cognition is beclouded, you cannot see that which is. You cannot see beyond your cognition, beyond your understanding. A Hindu cannot see beyond his Bhagavad Gita, that is sublime to him. A Muslim cannot see beyond the Holy Quran. A Christian cannot see beyond the Bible. And when the same ego brings happiness, when your Bhagavad Gita brings happiness to you, when your Bible brings happiness to you, you want to nourish ego. Both happiness and sorrow are two sides of the same coin. Both stay together and dissolve together as well. One moment you want to throw and next moment you want to preserve. These are the ways of the mind and the body. These are the ways of the body-mind realm. You have to remember that remaining within the scope of this keeps you enslaved, then freedom is not possible. You have to abandon all that. When he says abandoning all the religions, it means it is a very broad perspective, in a broad perspective, broad periphery, you have to abandon all that relates to the mind. The duality, the happiness and sorrows, the division between these. And body-mind realm, guided by that, creates ego, which is the false identity. The false identifying with ego is false. A false identity. An ego is a false entity. It appears to exist, however, in reality, ego ceases to exist. And everyone talks about that this man is very egoistic. His ego is very high, but does not know what does this mean. Mechanically, we go on using these words. Try to understand this. Ego is the sum of all your actions and thinkings. Ego is nothing tangible. All that you have done knowingly or unknowingly accumulates to give birth to ego. Ego is the concept of your doing. Ego is a dead past. You consider your scripture to be, and guided by that, you continue to live your life without understanding. You follow the ritualistic way without knowing, without going beyond that and considering it to be sublime. All this gives birth to ego. Ego is the concept of your doings. Ego is the dead past. From the very beginning, Krishna is saying that he alone is the only doer. Krishna is saying that consciousness, the cosmic law, is the doer. However, out of ignorance and negation of truth, you consider yourself to be the doer. Sarvadharmana Parityajya means you surrender to the cosmic law. Everything is happening because of a cosmic law, because of this synergistic harmony. You are simply an instrument. It is like you are going upstream. The river is flowing, but you are going in the river's direction. You have to struggle, you have to fight. But when you begin to flow with the river, you do not need to make any effort. The river will take you. Out of ignorance and negation of truth, you consider yourself a doer. The moment you consider yourself an instrument, ego disappears, ego dissolves. And that is the only criteria for ego to dissolve. The moment you consider yourself to be an instrument, the tree does not resist when the leaves fall. The tree does not resist when new foliage comes. This is the way for ego not to come in, for ego to dissolve. When happiness comes, it is coming because of the cosmic law. When the waves are arising, how do the waves arise? There is air, and when the air fills the certain upper layer of the water, a wave is formed. When you interact into the world of objects and beings, impressions are gathered. And you consider yourself that you are making the choices. It is actually your consciousness operating through the body-mind realm makes the choice. So all that effort is necessary is to cleanse that apparatus. The water is flowing through your tap. The tap has not been opened for a long time. So the water may come rusty. All you need to do is open the tap and allow it the water to flow. With the flow, the rust will disappear and the crystal clear water will start coming. If your cup is dirty, whatever you pour into it will appear to be dirty. All that is needed is to cleanse that cup. Mind is that cup. But you cannot consider yourself to be a doer. If you consider yourself to be the doer, the ego strengthens. And when you consider yourself to be an instrument, the water is coming from somewhere else. You are simply given an opportunity to collect that water in your cup. Water is coming from somewhere else. Consciousness is of that nature. It is of the beyond. It is coming to your mind. It is assuming the form of words. If your emotions are putrefied, the words will not be pleasant. If your energy is not flowing, then the words may not have that force, that energy, that magnetic force. That is the criteria of an awakened one. The moment you consider yourself an instrument, ego dissolves. Can you really find a person who considers himself to be an instrument? And there is a vast majority of pseudo who claim themselves to be religious. They do not understand the message of the sutra, Sarva Dharmana Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Braja. And because it is not possible for a man to surrender to an unknown, so Krishna says, surrender to me. This is really the essence of understanding. The moment you understand that there can be no wrong, your problem arises because you do not know the divine will. You do not know what is hidden, what is in treasure for you. This negation is the cause of your conflict and misery. Out of this arises sin. This negation creates the situation of self-suffering and pain to others. Considering yourself the doer is the veil or the maya. When you consider yourself to be the doer, then this is the veil of maya or illusion. The realization of this is knowing or knowledge or jnana or ecstasy, and also the essence of the message of Bhagavad Gita. One who understands this cosmic law is free of ego. He becomes an instrument. Arjuna's problem was that he was considering himself to be the doer. And when he was considering himself to be the doer, he cannot see beyond time and space. When you surrender to higher forces, to consciousness, your horizon of thinking, your horizon of understanding broadens. It becomes cosmic. You can see beyond time and space. The devotee who is aspiring for awakening sings the glory in many ways. However, none can really explain the magnanimity of that which is. How can you glorify the totality? Part can never glorify the totality. All your scriptures are incomplete description of that which is the cause of the entire existence. It is unsayable. Scriptures are like the fingers pointing towards the moon, but finger is not moon. Whatsoever is said in the scriptures is like fingers pointing towards the moon. It is still incomplete. Totality cannot be put into the words. It does not matter who says, whether it is Krishna says or Jesus says or Muhammad says. But we, out of ignorance, consider these sayings of the masters, sayings of the incarnations, as sublime. You remember these are for your transformation. At some stage or the other of your growth, you have to abandon all that. You may be holding a symbol as cross as a symbol, or Hindu using the Om as a symbol. But when you are actually, as long as your eyes are open, the symbol is important. The moment your eyes are closed, you are gone deep into meditation, the symbol disappears. It is no more there. No more visible. And for you, it is as if it does not exist. At the ultimate stage of your growth, you have to abandon all that is visible, all that is form. When your eyes are closed, the form that you are seeing is no more visible. You are simply feeling an energy coming to you, a warmth, a lovingness, and that is, it is like coming like an intoxication, as if you are sipping the mystical wine, sip by sip. And it is not that you are sipping it, it is dropping into your being, drop by drop. The sun is shining, an artist paints the sun. It may be beautiful, but it is no way it can give light. And if it was a reality, the sun, it would give light and warmth. When you put that painting of the sun in front of a tree, of a flower bud, when the bud will blossom, the painting of the sun is not alive. It may be beautiful. It cannot even allow the bud to blossom. Scriptures are like that paintings, which looks beautiful, but they are not alive. But in no way it can give light. The poet can sing the glory of the rising sun or compose beautiful poems. All these touch your heart, and that's where the falseness comes. You are touched by the beauty and the glory of the rising sun contained in the poetic way. May create ripples in your heart. Certainly all these cannot bring into your inner darkness. Scriptures are like these. Scriptures are like beautiful words, beautiful paintings of the rising sun. These may create ripples in your heart. Certainly all these cannot bring light into your darkness. The light will come into you when and only when the inner sun of awakening is opened into you. When the inner sun of awakening begins to rise, reaches its horizon, then there is light within. Only then the darkness is dispelled. All songs, narrations, scriptures are all incomplete. When you are really thirsty, the word water cannot quench your thirst. If you are not thirsty, then the word water will do. So when you are really thirsty, then you will search that which is existential. And the existential is not contained in the scriptures. The scriptures point out to you. When you finish, when you are studying for your degree, you hold on to your textbooks. A doctor, during the time when he is studying, he keeps the books of anatomy and physiology. When he goes into the actual practice, very rarely he may use the textbook because he is far beyond those textbooks. He has to search that which is beyond the textbook, which is not written in the book, textbooks. And that is what research is. Research. And here in the field of spirituality, it is in search. The search is within. He abandons all those books. I remember when my daughter was studying medicine, all the books were bought. The books were decorated on the shelf. When she finished her degree, she disposed of those books. Does it not happen when you finish your degree? Do you still preserve your books? You keep your prescriptions. You keep your bottles, empty bottles of the medicines, as long as you are sick. The moment you attain to health and the sickness is no more, do you keep those prescriptions? Do you keep those empty bottles of the medicines? No, you abandon all that because it is not needed. You have attained to health. When Krishna says, abandon all religions, sarva dharmana parityajya, he is referring to that state. When you have graduated, the books are not needed anymore. The prescriptions are not needed anymore. Then and only then the surrender is possible. Sarva dharmana parityajya mamekam sharanam braj. Come to the aware shelter of the awareness. As long as you are a student of any discipline, be it engineering or medicine, the books are like scriptures for you. Anything you need, you go into that. When you finish that, the form is no more available to you, no more relevant to you, because mastering those written words that were contained in those texts, you have attained to the degree. You have graduated. You have graduated mastering those words. Now you have to search that which is beyond those known. Beyond that which has been known to you, which has been prescribed. Do you keep the textbooks? Do you continue to study the textbooks after you graduate? Then you actually enter into the field of activity, the field of engineering, the field of medicine. You begin to experiment. Religion is an experience, going into the field of the unknown, experimenting every moment. And this is what Krishna says, sarva dharmana parityajya. Then you are using your own understanding, what you have gained. And with that there, your consciousness, you are entering into the realm of unknown, the consciousness. And that becomes your guiding force. Scriptures are abundant. they were relevant. They were relevant up to the stage. The textbooks were relevant up to the stage when you did not write your examination and your results did not come out. The moment you have completed the graduation, those textbooks are no more relevant to you. Then how can the Bible, the Gita, the Quran be relevant to you all your life? That means you have not yet graduated from your, you have not attained to that state of beyondness which Krishna speaks through this verse. Sarva dharmana parityajya, abandon everything. And everything does not mean holding on to your Bible. Abandon mean does not mean holding on to your Bhagavad Gita. If you is still holding on to your Bhagavad Gita or your religious scriptures, you have not understood the message of Krishna. The message contained in Bhagavad Gita has not been accessible, has not become a part of you. And the word dharam does not mean literally the religion, Hinduism, Christianity and Islam. Religion means all that known realm. Beyond the known, there is the realm of the unknown. Beyond the known is the realm of, it begins the journey into the unknown realm. Begins the journey into the mysteries of the existence, mysteries of the religiousness, mysteries of the consciousness. The poets, singers, philosophers go on insistently in their efforts to manifest the glories of God. You go on singing 1,000 times, you may get tired, but this does not mean you have gone beyond. Only you have to have the heart to feel. Yet still much remains unsaid. This is significant. He alone is the life giver. It is He that becomes the life force through your breath. It is He who is the cause of the existence, keeps on sharing, never demanding anything in return. You have to go. Sarva dharmana parityajya, mamekam sharanam braja. This does not mean you are holding on to your scriptures. Krishna says, abandon everything. Everything does not mean holding on to your scriptures. As long as you have not graduated, you can hold on to your textbooks. But the moment you graduate, those textbooks are no more relevant to you. How beautiful they may have been. And as a student, you preserved them, you respected them. But after that, you do not disrespect them. They are not needed for you. You give it to the people, give it to the other students who are now into that class. You have graduated those books. You have graduated those prescriptions. The moment Krishna says sarva dharmana parityajya, that means you have graduated Bhagavad Gita. You have graduated. No other preceptor has said so emphatically that you have graduated that prescription that is contained in Bhagavad Gita. And the moment you graduate from that prescription is no more needed. You do not carry your prescriptions when you are healthy. You carry on to your prescriptions as long as you are suffering. Bhagavad Gita is a prescription. Prescription to attain to that spiritual health. And if you continue to hold on to those scriptures, cannot understand the message of this preceptor, Krishna, the awakened one. Sarva dharmana parityajya mamekam sharanam braja aham tam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami mashucha. It is not the word that takes you beyond the state of duality. It is your awareness, it is your understanding, how well you have understood those prescriptions prescribed in the textbooks of your medicine, of your engineering or any other textbook. The scripture is a textbook that contains the prescriptions to go beyond that, to go beyond the state of duality. Whether you take the sutra, Sarvadharmana Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Vraj, Aham Tum Sarva Papebhyo Mokshayishyami Ma Shucha, or Yada Yada Hi Dharmasya Glanir Bhavati Bharat, Abhyutthanam Dharmasya Tadatmanam Srijamyaham, or Paritranaya Sadhunam Vinashaya Chadushkritam, Dharmasansthapnathaya Sambhavami Yuge Yuge. Whatever is the sutra, each sutra is a prescription. And Bhagavad Gita is a set of prescriptions. When doctor gives you a medicine, he prescribes something for you today. He takes you, gives you that prescription to go beyond that state of your sickness, state of your sickness. When you cross that state, he changes that prescription and prescribes something else. He said that that medicine is no more necessary for you. And finally, at the end, he says, no more medicine is necessary for you. No treatment is necessary. You have attained, you have recovered. The word recovery is used in medicine. And when Krishna says, Sarvadharmana Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam Vraj, he says to Arjuna, now you have recovered from that mental agony, that state of despondency that you have been when you have come to me in the first place. When the sutra of the Bhagavad Gita begins, it begins with Arjuna's despondency, the Arjuna disease. And that is what many commentators have used the word the Arjuna disease. Arjuna comes with a particular disease, that is a mental ailment, a psychiatric ailment. He comes to a psychiatrist in Krishna, Yogeshwar. And he gives him the prescription one after the other, abandoning all the symptoms of the sickness that he was suffering from. The mental sickness that he was suffering from, that was the cause of his wrong identification, that is slowly and slowly disappearing. Then when he finally reaches, he says, Sarvadharmana Parityajya, now you abandon all the prescriptions. All these prescriptions, all these suggestions are no more needed. You have attained to the state of beyondness. You enter into that state. But even after that, we hold on to our scriptures. You have graduated as an engineer. You have graduated as a medical doctor. Do you still hold on to your books? The books may be gathering dust. You may keep it as an ornament. That is a different thing altogether. Because you are not disrespecting the book that has contained so many prescriptions and has given you the degree of graduation. You do not disrespect them. But you are not disrespecting is one thing, and not being useful to you is a different matter altogether. When I say abandon the scriptures, I do not mean that you start disrespecting them. They are not needed anymore. When the clothes are worn, when clothes, you buy a new clothes, the old shoe that has given you a tremendous respect, tremendous protection, is no more needed. You have to go beyond that. You have to go beyond the scriptures in order, if you want to continue the spiritual realm. If you continue to hold on to your scriptures, you will never be able to understand the religiousness. You will never be able to understand that is which is beyond the religion. You will not be under the open sky. You will not be able to float. In the beginning, you learn the art of flying. And when you begin to fly, you float. Whatever discipline you take, each discipline has textbooks that prescribe certain prescriptions, certain ways and means for you to get into the nitty-gritty of that. But the moment when you do you think when a person, the pilot is flying the plane, he keeps his scriptures and his books, and when he is to turn the plane or to stop it, does he go into those scriptures? Does he go into those textbooks of flying that he has cherished once next to his heart? The moment he has graduated, he becomes a pilot. He is totally becomes a part of the consciousness that he can fly the plane without going into the scriptures. Why did Krishna end his dialogue? The Yogesh, there is no more sutra from Krishna. Sarva dharmana parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraj. Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami ma shuca. Why there is no need to have any more sutra after that? Because the end has come. End of knowing has come. Now you have to enter into the field. You have to allow those tenets to be part of your life as you traverse through the life's journey. You follow those tenets and continue to live. A religious person indeed is the one who is thankful for even small things. The moment you are filled with gratitude, prayer springs forth from deep within you. The moment you are filled with gratitude, prayer springs forth from deep within you. That day your prayer will be the expression of your gratitude, not your demands. You have known gratitude for the small. Your handkerchief falls, someone picks and gives it to you, or gives you a cup of tea, you are thankful. In all cases, you are thankful for such trivial things. You never feel gratitude towards God who keeps on giving you things. In your religious places, you visit to get your wish fulfilled. Never for a moment you pause to express your gratitude for all that is given to you. The essence of this is Sarva dharmana parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraj. Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami ma shuca. The essence is that the entire creation is not run by your whims and pleasures. Instead, it is run by an infallible law. And when you abandon that, you begin to flow. And when you begin to float, then you are in totally a different realm. This is the essence of Bhagavad Gita. Sarva dharmana parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraj. Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami ma shuca. No more prescriptions are needed. Abandon everything. Everything does not mean holding on to your scriptures. Abandoning does not mean holding on to your images. Abandoning does not mean holding on to your idols, to your symbols of religiousness. Those are necessary for the children. Sarva dharmana parityajya, abandon everything and come to me, to the realm of consciousness. As consciousness grows, understanding comes. Do you still consult your engineering and medicine books as you used to do when you were studying? Answer yourself this question. Prescriptions are no more needed. You have graduated. And that alone, that understanding alone, that prescription is no more needed. I have graduated. And the authorities, the awakened one in your discipline, have said that you have graduated. Krishna, the awakened one, says you have graduated. Abandon everything and only rely on consciousness. And that alone will help you to traverse through life's roads. Sarva dharmana parityajya mamekam sharanam braja aham tam sarva papebhyo mokshayashyami mashucha. Sarva dharmana parityajya mamekam sharanam braja aham tam sarva papebhyo mokshayashyami mashucha. No more prescriptions are needed now. Prescriptions in the form of scriptures, in the form of Bhagavad Gita, in the form of Bible, in the form of Holy Quran. You have graduated. Rely on your consciousness. That alone is sublime. That alone is infinite like a vast sky. That is unfathomable like ocean. Attain to that oceanic presence. Attain to that infinite horizon of sky. Consciousness is infinite like sky. It is unfathomable like ocean. Come to that, that alone. That is symbolic of me. I, the form and the formless are symbolic, are synonymous. Ocean has the quality, it is unfathomable and it has form too. The sky appears to be, it is infinite. The infiniteness is its quality. Unfathomable is the quality of the ocean. Go to the quality of that which is. Consciousness is unfathomable and infinite. Come to that, that alone. And that alone shall liberate thee of all thy despondency, the state of duality, the state of agony and pain, and render you in a state of blissfulness, render you in a state of ecstasy. Only this much for this morning on the talk of Bhagavad Gita. Sarva dharmana parityajya mamekam sharanam braja aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayashyami mashucha.